Hi, welcome to Latest TV News. I'm Mark Walker. Here are your local and national headlines for tonight. We look again at the pedestrianisation of Madeira terraces. We listen in on a curious discussion. We get an update from Mike Mendoza. We look at a unique homeless campaign. We speak to a Canadian author about the Holocaust. Plus, we visit the AmyVerse. So I'm here with Ollie Wilson. I'm going to be talking about the Madeira Drive and pedestrianisation. So welcome. Let's start off with the pedestrianisation. It's meant to be a temporary measure. You're a bit worried it's going to be a bit more permanent than that. And we're talking about the strip between the Sea Life Centre, the aquarium and Duke's Mound, aren't we? Which has currently been pedestrianised as a result of the COVID pandemic.
That's right. Yeah. The council has made it pretty clear that it intends to keep the closure of Madeira Drive, make it permanent, to keep it the way it is, despite the damage it's doing to the businesses, despite the way it's damaging the history and heritage and traditions of Brighton with the mods and the rockers going there. And it's received central government money to do this and other traffic changes. And it's really using that money to push its ableist and ageist agenda. So we have this strange situation where a Conservative government is funding a left-wing Momentum Labour and Green council to permanently change the traffic systems in Brighton and Hove in a way that's going to damage the local economy.
Yeah, and what the council have been saying on this, because where's public opinion? I mean, I think the council seem to believe that the public opinion's on their side. They're saying that it's being widely used, that area, now that it's been closed off to traffic. What's your thoughts? Because I know you've got your own poll.
Our petition.
Petition, yeah.
Has, as I speak, and by the time this is broadcast, it will be a lot higher. Our petition has received 7,500 signatures compared with about 2,500 for the opposing petition, which has completely stopped receiving signatures. It had a bit of a jump of about 1,500 after a mendacious email was sent out to Momentum supporters around Britain, many of whom probably have never been to Brighton and Hove, claiming wrongly that a permanent closure of Madeira Drive was official and, by implication of it being a national email, national Labour Party policy. So this incorrect email saying that they needed to support Labour, the Momentum Labour, in pushing this forward and making it permanent led to a jump. But that's completely dried up now. So we have vastly more support. We've started up a Facebook group in the first day that's put on 500 members. And there's a tremendous amount of support. People are constantly stopping me in the street and offering their support. Yeah. And I think people realise that this is an issue about human rights. It's an issue about freedom. It's an issue about inclusion. And the ableist council is pushing an agenda that is going to make it more difficult for the elderly, more difficult for disabled people to use Madeira Drive. It's going to stop mods and rockers from going down there, which is the tradition that's been going on since the early 60s. And it's going to damage the local economy with a lot of the businesses down there going out of business. Cyclists and runners and walkers who agree with us are more than welcome to attend.
Yeah.
And, you know, because we're not saying they can't use Madeira Drive.
Yeah. Okay. Ollie, thanks for coming today.
Thank you.
All the best for the campaign, and we'll catch up soon. Thanks.
Thank you.
I then spoke to two people who have set up a discussion forum with some very interesting key speakers. Here is my report. So I'm joined here today by Leaf and Elfie. So, and you're two comedians, aren't you, online? And I know that you've you're doing some curious discussions. I'm curious too, so just tell me, maybe we'll start off with Elfie. So what gave you the idea of, putting together some key speakers and, people joining online to listen in? Leaf, what inspired you to do this? I mean, a lot of people are listening to, going via Zoom to listen into really interesting people at the moment, aren't they, to get expert advice. I mean, I'm thinking Joe Wicks, that's more PE, but, people are getting their information via Zoom, so I guess this is the right time to launch this project.
And I think like Elfie and I had spoken about maybe doing a podcast last year. And I think when lockdown happened, it was like, okay, this is probably the best time to have a go. And just kind of, I found it really interesting just to kind of, you know, meet with people that, well, I've never met before and they're experts in their field. I'm learning things. We both are kind of a bit geeky and want to know the details around things, especially around sort of sciences and psychology, social change. I think that's really important. And also there's something just really quite charming, I suppose, about having, listening to a podcast and having it on in the background, pottering around. Don't know what people are up to and whilst they're doing it, I don't know, organising your fantasy novels or something, but having that chat in the background and learning something. And I think for us, it's always about learning something. And even doing the podcast, I've learned so much about, you know, how to engage with people I don't know, that sort of thing, manage their expectations. And from our podcast, I think we've also had other opportunities come our way as well. Just some people listening and saying, actually, I know someone who would be really good to speak with.
So what's the lineup looking like then for the next few weeks? Who have you got in the show?
Well, our most recent podcast is with James Dankert. So he's actually a scientist in boredom, if you can imagine. Yeah. So he's a specialist in the topic. He's a cognitive neuroscience scientist and just released a book that's really exciting. We've had a vegan bodybuilder on the show talking about how to get fit, how to get your buns looking really great for the summer. We've had a military interrogator on telling us about how to read body language and understand if someone's lying to you. So it's been a really varied lineup.
You guys are really focused on body language because obviously you're comedians, so you're looking for the reaction from the crowd. So what did you learn from that? I'm intrigued.
Oh, he's fantastic. So we learned about your pupils dilating. There's two occasions where your pupils dilate. Yeah. One, when you're looking at something you really, really like, really, really love. And one, when you're looking at something that really frightens you. And in his time training Navy SEALs, they were quite often asking him, how do I know which it is when I'm talking to a girl? So, he's got some great advice and some really interesting stories. He was a fascinating guy. The best place for comedy at the moment is probably Virtually Funny, which is every week on a Tuesday, Leaf.
Yeah, so I host a team of us, Virtually Funny. You can get it on Facebook Live. We've got a Virtually Funny page, and that's an open mic, new material night. We have people from all around the world.
Great, okay. Thanks for talking to us. All the best with the Curious discussions, and we'll catch up again soon. Lastly, for the first half, we now get an update from Mike Mendoza. I spoke to him in the studio. So I'm here with Mike Mendoza. We're going to be looking at the pandemic, the COVID pandemic, and what the recent developments are. The pubs have opened. Clubs have
barbershops are open.
Barbershops are open, so I had the haircut. It wasn't as bad as what we thought it was in terms of people crowding together spreading the COVID. It was more organised than what I thought it would be.
Yeah, I think most restaurants and bars that are opened are being very, very cautious, as they should be, of course. And they put a lot of measures in place. As you know, the barber shops, they're putting screens up. All those working there are wearing masks or shields of some sort. And I think they're all being very, very cautious, which is it's what they've got to. They want to survive. They want to carry on in business. And I'm sure if you go into a place and you're all on top of each other, you're not going to carry on going there.
Yeah.
Therefore, they've got to be very careful.
Yeah, exactly. I went to a pub in near Shoreham. It did seem organised. It was a bit strange, but... I mean, the beer garden worked pretty well. I mean, we were clearly all far apart and it wasn't table service, we went up to the bar.
Oh, really? I was surprised.
Yeah. So, but it seemed to work and there wasn't as many people as I thought there was. The football, they weren't showing the football, so maybe that was a reason why it was a bit emptier. But it was quite pleasant, actually. It was nice to have a pint, I have to say, and with my mum.
Was the atmosphere still there?
Yeah, the atmosphere was there. I mean, I was with my mum anyway, so we were chatting. But yeah, people were friendly and... Yeah, I mean, I think they were just slowly...
I wouldn't go into a pub at the moment, but I'll go in the garden. I mean, I've booked this week to go to a pub, but I've booked a table in the garden there because I know I'm going to be safe there. You've got the fresh air, you're far enough away from people not to have to worry about it, and it's table service. I mean, a lot of pubs now, that's what they're doing. You've got to book.
Yeah, OK, we'll leave it there for now, Mike.
Thank you.
We'll catch up again soon, I'm sure. Thanks for coming in today.
Thank you.
So we're going to have a bit of a police and crime update again. This comes on the back of me talking to the Sussex Police and Crime Commissioner, Katie Bourne, recently. There's a new chief constable for Sussex Police.
Jo Shiner.
Yeah.
First ever female police constable. And yeah. I think one of three female leaders in the police in the UK.
Yeah, so that's a big job, isn't it? And I know we got the Met Police Chief, Cressida Dick, so I think she comes after Jo Shiner, but she's got a big job in her hands, hasn't she? Because obviously
Absolutely. The
police, we're getting more police officers in Sussex, which Katie Bourne herself said, and I know that was a manifesto commitment for the Conservatives when they won power, but there's a lot, crime figures are going up, there's no doubt. That's it for the first half. Join us for the second half for a look at a unique homeless campaign in our city, a chat with a Canadian author, and a trip to the AmyVerse. Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm Mark Walker. Ollie Wilson spoke to me again about a unique homeless campaign in the city. Here is our report about the good work of DePaul. So I'm here with Ollie Wilson from DePaul Homeless Charity. I know you've got a great campaign about the hidden homeless in our city and nationally. Ollie, but tell us about DePaul first, because I've not heard of them before, but I know you're a big organisation based in seven countries.
Yeah, DePaul is an international homelessness charity. I work for DePaul UK, I'm the head of communications, and we work across the country with the Night Stop network, which includes a Night Stop in Brighton, Sussex Night Stop, as well as with supported accommodation, predominantly in London and the South East, in Manchester, in Newcastle and in Sheffield.
Yeah, what's your service? What do you offer? Because I know you're not necessarily based in Brighton, you're based in London, but you kind of do national work, don't you?
What we do primarily is hands-on work with young people who are experiencing homelessness. And a lot of this is offering them supported accommodation. So if they have been homeless or they're on the cusp of homelessness, we put them into supported accommodation, help them with their issues, if they have mental health issues or other health issues, their education, their training, employment, and give them a full service to help them to move on to independent living.
Yeah. Well, how big's the problem then nationally? It's obviously grown a lot recently, homelessness. I mean, has your workload increased quite a lot? Because we're seeing people not being able to keep up their rent. We're going to just be talking about surf, and that's going to increase in the future, isn't it? So the whole problem's going to get a lot worse, probably down the line.
Indeed, sadly, it's a huge problem for young people nationally. It's estimated from research that around 100,000 young people, people aged between 16 and 25, are currently homeless. A lot of them are not rough sleeping, but they're hidden homeless, which means that they're sleeping on friends' sofas or staying in other unsafe places and from night to night. So it's a very precarious living for them. And this, during the COVID crisis, has become a lot worse. And this is part of the reason why we've launched the Sleep Bedless campaign.
Yeah. Yeah, and what's that Sleep Bedless campaign about then?
Well, it's to raise money for DePaul to cover the extra costs of the coronavirus crisis that we've incurred hundreds of thousands of pounds in extra costs and also lost income from cancelled events. Extra costs come from things like purchasing PPE for our services. We run around 90 services, not including Night Stop nationally, I'm proud to say we've managed to keep all of them running, but obviously it's been very challenging for our staff to do this, and we've had to spend an awful lot on personal protective equipment.
Yeah. So how do people get involved in that then?
Well, what we're asking people to do is to join the campaign online. You can read about it at the DePaul UK website, at the Sleep Bedless page. You can go, it's the URL is thepoorcharity.org/sleepbedless, or you'll see it on social media. And what we're asking people to do for one night is to sleep out of their bed. That might be on their sofa or on the floor or in the bath, or the person who launched the campaign, Strictly Come Dancing star Neil Jones, slept just outside his flat on the balcony for a night, and then talked about his experiences of homelessness.
Yeah. Okay, it looks like you're doing some great work. So, well, catch up again soon. Thanks for coming in again today, Ollie. All the best for the campaign.
Thank you.
Thanks. Now, a flat chat with a Canadian author, Sharon Hart Green, who spoke to Angie Mariani about her new book via Skype.
Well, we're joined by a special guest today, Sharon Hart Green, who's a writer and academic from Toronto University Press, and who's written a first novel, Come Back For Me. Sharon, can you tell us a bit about your work?
Sure, I'm delighted to be on the show. Come Back For Me is what I would call a post-Holocaust novel. It explores the trauma of the war and the repercussions of it on two generations of Jewish families, one family in Europe and the other one in North America. And it follows their lives and the two stories, it's told in intersecting narratives, and the two stories, you don't realize at the beginning that they have much to do with one another, but they are intricately linked. So, that's the basic format of the novel.
Okay. And you've called it, in the description, a post-Holocaust novel. Is that right?
Yes, post-Holocaust, because most of the story takes place after the war. And the first narrative is about a young man named Arthur Mandelkorn, who's from Hungary, and he's in search of his sister, whom he believes has survived the war, although he has no absolute evidence for it, but he's convinced that he survived, and he goes on a journey trying to find her. And the second narrative is about a young woman in Canada who lives in the late 60s. It's many years later. And she comes from a family of Holocaust survivors and presumably has nothing to do with Arthur Mandelkorn, although you have hints of it as the story continues, that she has some connection to his family. And she herself has undergone trauma when her uncle, who's a survivor, dies mysteriously, and she is in search of answers, and her family is very reticent to talk about what happened during the war.
Very interesting. I look forward to reading it. And you're working on another novel as well at the moment.
I am. I taught at the University of Toronto for quite a few years, and I decided to take a break from teaching, and I ended up devoting myself to writing, and now I'm still on a break from teaching because I've decided that fiction writing is so much more satisfying to me.
Well, it's been a pleasure talking to you, and we look forward to sharing information about your books, and best of luck with it. Thank you very much for joining us today.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
Lastly, Angie Mariani spoke to Amy Goebel from the AmyVerse about all things letters and words. Here is her report.
Hello, and I'm with Amy Goebel from the AmyVerse, a calligrapher from Brighton. And now, during the lockdown, many businesses have had to adapt to new ways of working, and the AmyVerse, I understand, is one such business. Amy, can you tell us a bit about it?
Yeah, of course. So, as you said, I'm a calligrapher and illustrator, and I offer bespoke wedding stationery. That's one of the main things that I do. But obviously, with lots of weddings being postponed at the moment, and a lot of uncertainty around when social gatherings are going to be allowed, that line of my work has been put on hold at the moment. And so that was obviously something that was really worrying, especially in March, when I sort of started to get the trickle of emails saying that their wedding was going to be postponed, and that's something sort of ongoing. So I've been looking at other ways that I can adapt my business to make the most of this really difficult situation. And one thing that I've noticed is that my card sales and gifts have really boosted at the moment, because lots of people while they're at home are looking for ways to send loved ones gifts and messages. So my Etsy shop has been really popular at the moment, so that's been really lovely. And then one of my main passions is calligraphy. And I get a lot of satisfaction from creating calligraphy. It's something that I find really enjoyable and rewarding, and it really helps me de-stress. And so I wanted to share that love of calligraphy with other people. So I've designed modern calligraphy kits so that people can learn calligraphy from the comfort of their own home.
Okay, so with the proliferation of arts and crafts during lockdown, these kits give some people a new skill to learn.
So, absolutely.
Can you tell us a bit about modern calligraphy? How does that differ from traditional calligraphy?
Yeah, so one of my favourite things with modern calligraphy is, unlike traditional calligraphy, which is quite strict, modern calligraphy is very free and expressive. So you can really put your own personality and spin on the words and letters that you're creating. It's very artistic, which I think is why I'm so drawn to it. I love drawing and painting. And so for me, that style really suits the type of work that I like to create. So the letters are a bit looser and freer. And also it's really enjoyable to create, and it's perfect for beginners as well, because the tools that I give you in my kits are things that you can use really easily. So it's a brush pen, so you can just start calligraphy there and then. You don't need lots of equipment. And then with the workbooks, there's lots of activities, so you can sort of go through it at your own pace with my instructions. But yeah, so modern calligraphy is, yeah, a little bit different to that traditional style, but still really fun.
Okay, fair enough. Thank you very much for giving us an insight into a craft business based in Brighton, but reaching far beyond Brighton, and showing us how a local business can adapt with within these new times. Thank you very much.
That's it for today. Join us for tomorrow for more of your local news stories. Tomorrow, good night.